What's up, everyone? Welcome to Bilbrons and Dragons. I'm your host, Bilbron DaoLockStone. So today we're having another battle report for my Molebron DaoLockStone build, which I've been playing in a Westmarch server called the Forged Concordance, and I think it is super awesome. So I put all of the relevant information about the Forged Concordance in the video description below. Feel free to check it out and we can adventure together. So today's episode is called Knick, Knack, Catastrophe, run by DM Grammoth, who I think did a great job. The storyline was really cool because, unbeknownst to me going into this adventure, it was actually part two of an adventure that I had done before. It was the Cask of Memories adventure, which I think was only literally my second session at the Forged Concordance way back when I was second level. So check that out, and that'll set you up for this one, but you don't have to watch it. I'll describe everything. So I rolled up to the job board looking for a gig, and Bilbron saw Idik and Donk looking to put a team together. And I've already adventured with these guys a couple of times, Idik like three times already. So that was cool. High fives, catch up. And that was the team. Idik was a goblin Meridlock, and Donk is a pretty jovial half-orc barbarian. So we needed two others, and we saw Titian, a Tortle Bladesinger, whom Idik and I had adventured with before in the With the Night one-shot. So Idik went to go recruit him, and then I saw Rav, who I adventured with in the Cooking Up That Good Voodoo adventure. So I had adventured with all of these guys before, and so I knew it was going to be a great team. Rav was a Loxodon Wildfire Druid. So it was the five of us, and we headed out to the Leaky Loaf Tavern to meet our clients. And I should say that we got a job description that was weird. The first part was written in common, and it was super crude, as you can see. And then that part that you can't see turned out to be written in Draconic. And it wasn't until Titian was recruited that we could read that part, because apparently turtles and dragons are related. I would have never guessed, but apparently way back, I guess I can see the reptile thing. But he was able to read it, and the Draconic part was like super articulate and erudite, and they both basically requested the same thing: come to the Leaky Loaf Tavern, because they're having some problems with hags. And I've got a history with hags. I got disemboweled by a hag way back when, and I fought them a few times, so I was like, yeah, let's go kill some hags. So we headed out to the Leaky Loaf Tavern, and then when we got there, I was like, oh my god, I've been here before! This is where it's Leaky and Loaf! And they sent us out to kill some kobolds that were harassing them, but it turns out the kobolds were actually pretty good dudes, and we talked it out and we made friends, and it turns out that they had been ordered around by a giant ogre that had come to their little tribe and was pushing them around and making them do this stuff. So we killed the ogre for them and liberated it. So I was like, all right, awesome. And I remember telling the kobolds that, hey, the Leaky Loaf Tavern, they're cool. You should check them out, hoping that they would become patrons. So it was so cool. We went in and I said hi to Leaky, said hi to Loaf. And they said, hey, Bilbron, what's up? Business is great. And then I look in and I see two kobolds from the tribe that we had liberated. And I was like, guys, what's up? And it turns out they were our clients, Knick and Knack, the two kobolds. Knick was the one that had written in common, whereas Knack was the professorial type that had written that really articulate part of the note. So we met up with them, and they were really anxious and impatient for us to arrive because they were really stressed. And it turns out that the ogre that we had killed was himself actually taking orders from a coven of hags. And now the hags were threatening the kobolds. They had commandeered this dwarven underground complex that had been abandoned and turned it into their new cave. But they were encountering trouble from, these hags that were trying to exert their influence over that region. And the hags had threatened them with death and said that they were all going to be dead by the night of the full moon, which was the next night. So they were like, oh, thank God you guys are here. We totally need protection. These hags are causing massive trouble. They already tried to attack us once, and fortunately, a group from the Forged Concordance was able to turn them back and kill one of the hags. But there's still, like, you know, a four hag coven out there trying to kill us, and we really need some protection. So we're like, hey, we're in, bro. So they took us to their complex. It's a pretty short journey away. The last part of it was through this, like, really narrow secret tunnel. And they brought us to the complex, which I put a map up. It was pretty big. I mean, awesome place to live, right? I don't know why the dwarves abandoned it, but, like, if I was a kobold, I'd be like, dude, this cave is the best. So yeah, really cool cave. And we arrived towards the end of the night. So we just did some quick introductions and a quick tour of the place. And then we bedded down for the evening. The next day, we prepared for the assault that we were expecting that evening. So Idik and I went with Knick out to scout the witch's forces because we were the most stealthy. And so we went out, we didn't roll great, but we did manage to learn that amongst the witches or the hags' shock troops were zombie ogres and a zombie direwolf. And then some kind of humanoid figure that was directing them, but we couldn't get a good look at that. So we went back, and in the meantime, the others had gone off with Knack to forage for raw materials. The idea being that we wanted to fortify the complex in, you know, preparation for this assault that we were expecting. So we all met back in the early evening and reported our findings, and then we took those raw materials and we built fortifications. And it was a really cool game mechanic because of the search rolls that the foraging group came up with. We were able to place like 20 squares worth of fortifications. And there was like all these different kinds that we could choose from between spike walls and, boulder walls and pit traps and stuff like that. And so we deployed it, and it was like a really cool discussion and, you know, thought process about like, what should we do? Should we do this? You know, what's better? That's something that I've rarely encountered in D&D. So I thought that was like a really cool nuance, and we all had a lot of fun with it. So we decided to block off the two secret entrances on the east and the west, and then create like a really strong choke point up near the cave entrance, fronted by a couple of pit traps. And we felt pretty confident that that was a good setup. And then we arranged ourselves in strategic positions, awaiting the assault. And we were able to convince the kobolds to pitch in on the defense. They didn't really want to, being quite cowardly, but Idik talked to them and was able to persuade them to, you know, help defend themselves. And the fact that Idik and I could both create magic stones, and then each of the kobolds could take a stone and then offer some, you know, meaningful resistance, was a good strategic option, and it did convince them to help. Which turned out to be kind of a mistake, but at the time it made a lot of sense. And so we set up three kobolds in this little hidey hole up near the top right, which you'll see it was like 20 feet off the ground, and it had just like a tiny little arrow slit kind of thing. So it was like perfect for that. And Idik's familiar spot was up there because he was the one that needed to create magic stones. And then we had another position of three of them in the back with Fargar, who was also supposed to create magic stones. And that was the plan. And then the assault happened. You know, we heard them approach, and they, you know, invaded the front entrance. And that part was easy because Idik just threw up a Sleet Storm. And Sleet Storm, again, is one of those powerful third level spells in 5th edition. And so that one was pretty easy. Like, if these ogres and direwolf entered the Sleet Storm, would fall down, would get up, had to push slowly through the difficult terrain, then they would run into the pit trap, and then they couldn't get through the walls, and then there was one area of the choke point, and there was my summon stone golem, my reskinning of the, you know, summon shadow spawn right there. And in the meantime, Rob and Titian are just blowing them up with fire spells, and Donk is chucking javelins, and we've got the three kobolds up there chucking magic stones. So it seemed like it was going pretty well, but a ghost managed to kind of sneak in and was poking her head in on that kind of northeast side, and then managed to get into that little cavern where we had the three kobolds and Idik, Idik's familiar. So that sucked. The ghost possessed one of the kobolds, And then Itix Familiar tried to go non-lethal on it and still killed it instantly because it got this epic damage roll, which, you know, killed it through massive damage, even though it was non-lethal, which was annoying. And then the ghost managed to kill another one before Rob's Wildfire Spirit managed to, you know, take care of it. And that was annoying because part of the win conditions was that we had to protect the kobolds, and there had to be at least two kobolds left if we wanted to get paid. And there was only seven total, and two had just gotten killed. And we're like, oh man, that sucks. But, you know, we decided to, you know, keep going. You know, not much else we could do, but, you know, we did decide to pull them back out of that dangerous area. And then the second wave came in really sneaky. It was like a couple of quicklings, which I had never seen before. And these things are so fast. Oh my God, I guess they have like 120 foot move speed. So when they dash, it's like 240. Crazy, man. So they came in through the front and literally just dashed like almost all the way to the back. And this is when we started getting clued into the, wait, they're not even really attacking us. They're just going for the kobolds. This sucks. And yeah, so we barely managed to turn back that wave. There was also pixies in it, I should say, which had turned invisible and then stealthed in because none of us had a great passive perception. And they were problematic. They were casting like polymorph spells and stuff. So yeah, the second wave was quicklings and pixies. And we barely managed to turn them back because, again, they weren't coming for us. They were going for the kobolds. And it was close. So, but that clued us in. And so for the next wave, we decided to round up all of the kobolds and put them in this little storage room where Bilbron had actually kind of headquartered himself because he doesn't need to actually be in the you know, immediate vicinity to be effective because he's got Voice of the Chainmaster. And so we rounded up all of the remaining kobolds and put them in that room with Bilbron to babysit them. And we awaited the next wave. And the next wave was by far the sneakiest. They had a pretty decent strategy of sending some loudly baying Yeth hounds to the front. And they started like baying before they got close. And that totally drew our attention. Itik even went outside to check him out because he's kind of a stealth expert with, you know, being a goblin and all, bonus action hide and stealth expertise, etc. And he, you know, kind of led the resistance there, but Bilbron was in the back storage room, and we'd also set up a kobold as kind of a watch near the cave where the hatchlings were, because we didn't want the, you know, bad guys to kill the hatchlings. And so the main assault did draw most of the attention, and so most of the folks were up there near the front, you know, concentrating on the Yeth hounds and such. A couple of quicklings also kind of tried to dart through the front, and so that was a, you know, concern for the main guys. But it turns out that the enemy was able to penetrate to the interior of our defenses, and the kobold that we had set to guard the hatchling room started shouting out, hey, a badger just dug its way in here. That's pretty sus, right? So Itik was immediately all on that and investigated and was like super suspicious and attacked it right away. And then it turned into this giant frickin' troll. I guess it was polymorphed or something. And I'd never fought a troll before, but it was huge and ugly and it was regenerating. And this particular one was like super pustulous and like poison ridden. And every time you'd hit it, it would like spray poison everywhere, which was quite problematic. And at the same time, in the storage room, a pixie had managed to stealth in there and then entangled everyone in the room. And then the hag showed up in that room. Eesh. So yeah, the battle was on three fronts. Most of the folks up front taking care of the Yeth Hounds and the Quicklings. And then Itik's attention got drawn towards the Venom Troll. And Bilbron was fighting in the storage room against the hag. And I was, you know, doing damage to the hag, but I couldn't stop it from killing two of the kobolds. So that wasn't good. And luckily, everybody else managed to kill all of their enemies. And then we all descended on the hag in that storage room and surrounded her and were beating her down. But somehow she managed to turn invisible and hide and get away, which was super annoying. But then Rav, in a hero moment, estimated her likely position based on the timing, managed to drop a fairy fire into that location. Sure enough, she was there and he got her. So she became visible again. We pressed the attack. Victory seemed imminent. And then a little curveball at the end. One of the pixies that the hag was commanding saw her chance to betray the hag and escape her control. And just as the hag was staggering, hit her with a sleep spell, knocked her unconscious, and was like, we're all good, right? And then skedaddled, even though Fargar tried to flirt with her a little bit because, you know, they're about the same size and, you know. But yeah, Donk executed the hag and we defeated the mission. We managed to keep three surviving kobolds. That was the win condition. We needed at least two. So Knick and Knack were pleased, and I was happy to help them out. You know, I consider them buddies. So told them, hey, you know, I know you still got trouble with Coven of Hags. Give us a call if they cause any more trouble, or if you can find the location of their HQ, we'll be happy to go smash them for you. And yeah, that was it. We went back to the Forged Concordance HQ. We got some really good treasure for our trouble, 350 gold and a stone of good luck and some mood mark paint. So yeah, the rewards are starting to get a lot better as I level up. So that's it. That was a great adventure, I thought. It was not one that we were really in personally danger of because the win conditions were about controlling the keeping the kobolds alive, and the enemy was mostly trying to kill them. But it was problematic. Like, it was tough to keep them from dying. And I really enjoyed the strategic elements of it, where, you know, you can make certain decisions. Like, I was in that storage room, but I didn't have to be. I was just trying to stay one step ahead because it just seemed to me like, okay, if I was assaulting a position, you know, tricksiness is good. Let's get a lot of, you know, noise and stuff going in one area, draw people's attention, and then attack from the, you know, the flanks. And I was able to, you know, be like, nah, I think you guys are fine at the front. I'm going to just stay here in the back just in case. And it was a good decision. And I appreciate it when decisions like that have strategic and tactical importance. So great mission. And thanks to DM Grammoth for providing it to me. Thanks to the team for, you know, being so great. And thank you for watching. This has been Bilbrons and Dragons. I'm your host, Bilbron Bafflestone. See you next time.